Oh, yeah, Arnie? But what about $99 a week here in sunny California? Yeah!
Or, OJ, only $69 a week here in sunny Florida.
Brutal, Juice, brutal.
Hertz Affordable USA. Rates guaranteed through May 31st.
Howl with the Wolfman tonight at 7:30.
We're in the Southern California desert north of San Diego in a place called Carlsbad. These motorcycles are racing on a course like none other in the sport. The event is the Superbikers, and the course is one that combines elements of all the surfaces that motorcyclists race on. You'll see them on the asphalt of the road courses, the flat curves of dirt track, and the uphill, downdale excitement of motocross. The object here is to see which rider is best able to handle all the surfaces, to be the best all-around racer of them all. Stand by for the Superbikers on ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Also today on Wide World, a Women's World Cup downhill race which was supposed to have taken place yesterday. But with the world's best women downhill skiers warmed up in the French Alps and competing, a heavy fog moved in to drape the mountain which overlooks the alpine village of Megève. And when the race was interrupted to await a break in the weather, a malfunctioning timer ended all hope of a continuation. 13 women had descended the course. The cancellation cost leader Irena Epla of West Germany a possible victory, but it gave new life to all the other skiers you'll see today in the reincarnation of the women's downhill at Megève. Motorcycle racing from California, Women's World Cup skiing from France, today on ABC's Wide World of Sports.
An aerial view of part of the course in which this year's Superbikers Championship will be contested. As the day goes on, you'll see the riders from many angles as they make their way around the two-mile circuit.
Hello, I'm Jim McKay reporting from the race course here in Carlsbad, California. You know, in this day and age of super specialization in sports, of offensive teams and defensive teams and special teams and designated hitters and all that sort of thing, this event, although a comparatively new event, is really a sort of a throwback to the days when what we were really looking for in sport was the all-around athlete. In this case, the all-around motorcycle racer, the man who can handle any or all of the surfaces that this sport presents, whether it's the hard asphalt or the road course or the dirt track or the motocross. To find the best all-around man, they have gathered together here some of the best racers in the world, among them four present or former world champions, five present or former national champions. They'll be going on this specially designed course. Today you'll be seeing on Wide World of Sports a heat for each of the divisions, for the motocross, for the dirt track, and for the road course men. The top three finishers in each heat will move on to the final you'll be seeing next week on Wide World. There will be a fourth heat, a sort of a repechage, second chance, or a wild card heat, in which three more men will go to the final. There will be then altogether 12 racers in the final that you'll see next week. Today, though, the qualifying heats, our expert on the sport, Sam Posey, had an opportunity a little bit earlier to look at this race course itself from an unusual viewpoint, from a helicopter. Here's what he saw.
Well, thank you, Jim. As you said, this track is like no other anywhere in the world, and it's great to have this viewpoint looking down from the chopper. The man who's going to be carrying our camera for us, Jimmy Felice, you see him there, 22 years old. He's said to have a great future in the sport. What we'll be seeing is the view from his motorcycle there as he sets out onto the course. The first part of the lap is 1.1 miles long. It is the pavement part that the road racers will feel especially at home on. It has five turns. You see Felice negotiating the first of those there, that hairpin turn. Now he heads down this little downhill into a sweeping right-hand turn. A pair of lefts will follow this. Now this road racing part of the track, it looks wide from here up in the air, but they say that only one racing line really works through it, so overtaking is very hard. He's behind the pits now and accelerating towards the very fastest part of the track. There's a little downhill. Now he's climbing third gear, fourth gear, fifth gear here for a second, 115 miles an hour or more, but now he brakes very, very hard as he heads down into the hairpin, the slowest part of the track. Right there, he almost gets out of shape. From the pavement part that the road racers are expert at, they go to the dirt, and you'll see he's going just now under the bridge there, and as he goes under the bridge, he makes a transition into dirt. This is a 45, 50 mile an hour section here, third gear. He's headed for a long 180 degree turn that climbs. They do most of the steering here with the throttle, not with the handlebars, but with the throttle. Ahead is the jump, The Turf Trophy jump. There he is, up into the air, 5 feet or more. Then back hard and looking ahead toward the motocross section of the track. This is the roughest part of the track by far. Gullies and ruts to trap the unwary rider. Very difficult here to force the bigger, heavier bikes like the Harley-Davidson through this section. What you want here is agility. This is the most demanding part of the track physically. And curiously, it's said to be very easy to pass. Oh, Jimmy Felice almost loses it there for a second. All right, now he's headed down off the dirt section across a wooden bridge and back out onto the pavement. One chicane ahead of him now. There were two last year, so the track is faster than ever. There's the chicane, the finish ahead, the end of the lap.
Thank you, Sam. Well, it's time now for the crowd to abandon the hamburger stands and turn their attention to the course, because we're ready for Heat 1. The contestants of this are from the world of motocross. Now, this is their usual workplace, a kidney-jolting, energy-draining series of jumps, ruts, and hairpin turns. But now, they must master other types of surfaces, too. There they are on the starting grid. Among those on the first row is the current world champion Håkan Carlqvist of Sweden and a former world champion Andre Malherbe. Inside of the second row, we have the defending champion here, Danny Magoo Chandler. Number five there is Malherbe, eight is Carlqvist. And here they go, Sam. They're racing in Carlsbad, headed for that first turn, which comes up very quickly. And it is Carlqvist of Sweden, the current world champion, taking the lead. Second is Malherbe. And third, well, that's a battle right now, as you can see.
And when you're trying to have a bike for this kind of competition, Jim, this unique competition, it's tough to know what sort of tire to put on it. And the tires they use have to be a compromise for all the surfaces. They're very hard to ride on this pavement. They slide a lot on the pavement.
This, of course, is a very unfamiliar surface to these riders. These are motocross men, remember, and it'll be a bit before they get to their surface on the first lap of this two-mile course. So it's still Carlqvist, Malherbe, number five, right behind him, and Malherbe making a move for the lead as they come to the hairpin. Let's see if he holds it as they go through. There he is, and yeah, he's got him. Andre Malherbe of Belgium, former world champion, now leading the race. Carlqvist second, and the defending champion here, Danny Magoo-Chandler, number one, has moved into third.
All right, well, now they're headed onto the dirt part where they're going to feel far more at home. These are those sweeping turns that precede that long climbing left-hand turn.
This is not their familiar motocross surface, but it is at least dirt.
Yeah,
soon and they'll come to that jump that leads into the motocross.
The bikes feel a whole lot better balance there. You saw Chandler move up into second.
And Rick Johnson, number 18, was making a bid, but suddenly bobbled and dropped back a little bit. But now he's getting back into it again.
Rick Johnson is a real comer. He's very young, 19 years old. There's Andre Malherbe there, the former world champion. Look at that racing.
Tremendous racing, and particularly for third right now with Danny Magoo-Chandler and Rick Johnson, the 19-year-old. And Johnson's moved into third. Number 18 there. He's taken third place from the defending champion.
Now they're going across that wooden bridge for a split second, and now out onto the pavement, where again, as I said earlier, the bikes feel really at their worst out here on the pavement.
Leading the first lap as they come through the chicane and nearing the finish line is Malherbe, Ben Carlqvist, and Rick Johnson at age 19, and then the defending champion, Danny Chandler. What kind of machines do they ride on? Well, Sam Posey explored that subject.
Have a close-up look at a professional motocross machine. This one happens to be a Yamaha, and this bike and others like it are the best way that man has yet devised to cover rough terrain in a hurry. Notice its enormous clearance above the ground. Notice that the steering enables you to take extremely sharp hairpin turns, that the knobbly tires get a terrific grip in dirt and all sorts of terrain. By contrast, the Husqvarna Superbike is really not very different. It's a little bit lower to the ground in order to give it better stability in the fast paved turns of this track here at Carlsbad, and it has an all-terrain tire so that it can go not only on the dirt but on the pavement. But essentially, the two bikes are really very similar.
Now back to the action on the course. Still Andre Malherbe in the lead, Danny Chandler second, and Rick Johnson third.
Notice the speed here on the straight, Jim. They have removed two of the chicanes that were in the straightaway in previous years.
On the hard surface, on the pavement now, headed down the hill, and Danny Chandler making a move, but can you get him on the inside? Let's see, Sam.
Ooh, awfully close.
What a move.
Woo! Very exciting riding. And bear in mind, neither of these men that familiar with the pavement. I noticed that in the turn before Danny Chandler made his pass, he took a completely different line through it than Andre Malherbe. So on the ground that they're not familiar with, it's interesting to see what these men are up to, where they have to think their way around the track instead of just feeling it with the benefit of their experience.
Around that hairpin once again, and Danny Chandler, the defending champion, holds the lead.
Ford Escort. It's engineered with four-wheel independent suspension for a smoother ride than this Japanese import. It's engineered with more passenger room than this Japanese import. Plus, Escort has more standard features than this Japanese import. And now with the new available 2-liter diesel engine, Ford Escort is engineered for better mileage ratings than this Japanese import. Have you driven the best-built American cars? Have you driven a Ford lately?
Inside the American Airlines maintenance base, where professionals like Richard McCormick run thousands of checks on our planes inside and out as part of our comprehensive maintenance program. At American, we spend over $1 million a day keeping our planes up to the highest standards, but there are some things you just can't put a price on.
We're American Airlines, doing what we do best.
If emergencies never happened, you might never need a tire as good as Tiger Paw Plus with Royal Seal from Unaroyal. But you might. The reassuring protection of Unaroyal technology. Tiger Paw Plus with Royal Seal from Unaroyal. You may never need a tire this good.
That's what the leader looks like. That's Danny Magoo Chandler, defending champion, still in first place. Malherbe still second. And now Brock Glover is third.
As you can see, there are parts of this section of the track, Jim, that are still quite damp. In fact, it was so muddy earlier, they had to delay the start of this heat.
Danny Chandler still with no problems out in front. The race for second, Malherbe and Brock Glover. Now Johnson dropping back just a bit.
You know, in this kind of terrain, especially with the sidelong lighting like this, to be able to read the surface of the track, exactly the sort of skill that a riverboat pilot might have, Jim, to sense out where the eddies and currents are. You've got to pick out where those ruts and deep gullies are and keep your bike away from them.
Now coming to the start-finish line for the white flag. One lap to go. One lap to go in the first heat for the motocross men. Still, Danny Chandler in the lead, defending champion. Andre Malherbe, former world champion, in second place. Brock Glover third, and Rick Johnson fourth, trying to figure out how in the world he can get by Brock Glover on this final lap.
A tremendously mature ride by Danny Chandler, biding his time, not needing to take the lead right off the bat. And once he got the lead, did not feel under pressure to exhibit a lot of extravagant riding tactics. He kept the bike comfortably underneath him, and that lead he's kept about the same in about a second and a half.
Johnson simply doesn't have the speed on the road course. As you can see, he loses ground every time on the road course, so if he's going to get third place, he's going to have to do it with very skillful riding on the motocross section.
Now, Brock Glover, of course, is the man on the bubble, so to speak, at this point, under attack from Johnson, and we've got only this half a lap to go as they go under the dirt, and Brock Glover, the bike kicked out. This may be Johnson's best shot at him.
Johnson closing in on Brock Glover. That's the big race now, the race for third place. The first two men seem secure. Danny Chandler and Andre Malherbe. And now it looks, oh, he almost got him that time.
Here they come to the TT jump. They are neck and neck.
They sure are. Glover's still in the lead, but Johnson just on his tailpipe. Well, boy, this still could go either way.
It's very exciting, and the ferocity of the battle has caused them to close up on Malherbe. It's really a three-way, Jim.
Right. Look at Johnson on the outside, trying to make a move, couldn't quite do it. He's got to find room here. Once they get to that hard pave surface, you don't have very much time to catch him, and he has not been as fast as the others on the pavement.
No.
Here they come. Oh. Look at this.
Oh, and this chicane is ahead.
Yeah. One more move could be made here. He didn't make it. So it's Danny Chandler, Andre Malherbe, and Brock Glover moving on to the final from the men of motocross. Here was the decisive moment. It came on the second lap of this heat. Malherbe, number five, leading the race, but here came Chandler. Danny Magoo on the inside with a very daring move. Only has about 2 feet to maneuver with as he comes around the second turn on the hard paved surface of the race course. Danny Magoo with a good illustration of how to ride a motorcycle and take the lead. Sam?
Danny, you've spoken of maturing as a rider. How would you judge your performance in winning that heat?
Well, I rode really fast and I rode really smooth. I just, paid my time, bided my time, and I lucked out and won it.
But you didn't lead at the beginning. What thoughts were going through your mind? Did you want to get in the lead right away? You seemed to take your time.
Well, I wanted to get, in the lead right away, of course, but, I had to just buy my time, just pick them off when I thought I had a good chance, instead of jeopardizing and taking a chance of going down. So I just took my time, and, it played off well.
Okay, you've got a fair amount of dirt and mud all over you. How is the track condition?
Well, it's just a little bit slick right now. I think it's just about right, really. Earlier today it was real muddy, and with those tires, it's really hard to, control the bike. But they've put a lot of new dirt on the track, so it's pretty good now.
Congratulations to you.
Thank you very much, Sam.
These three, then, have moved on to the final of the Superbikers. Danny Chandler, Andre Malherbe, and Brock Glover. Coming up, the heat dedicated to the dirt track races. Remember, three from each discipline of the sport will move on to the final. We'll be back for that.
Working hard when the heat is on could mean perspiration odor. Right Guard antiperspirant helps stop wetness better than the leading spray, as it kills the bacteria that can cause perspiration odor.
Introducing new Gillette Foamy Gel. The gel that gives you more than any other gel. More lubricants. Better beard setup. More lubricants. Smooth takeoff. More lubricants. For the closeness and comfort you want in a shave, get new Gillette Foamy Gel. The gel that gives you more.
In 1983, the U.S. women's ski team came of age and achieved the world's number one ranking. They are led by Tamara McKinney, the first American woman ever to win the overall World Cup title. Kristen Cooper, who hopes to recover from last year's injury and regain her top form. And three-time Olympic veteran Cindy Nelson. The U.S. women's ski team is on top of the world, and they intend to stay there and bring home gold from Sarajevo, Yugoslavia. Starts February 6th on ABC.
Not a cloud in the California sky as we prepare for the dirt track qualifying heat of the Superbikers. Both asphalt and motocross surfaces will be unaccustomed to them. They normally race on oval dirt tracks, similar to horse race tracks at state fair half-mile circuits. Now here's Sam with their machines.
This is the Harley-Davidson oval track racer with which they contest the national championship. As you can see, it's a massive machine built for very high speeds, extremely powerful bike. On the ovals, no front brake is required. You see, there's no brake here on the front, and the engine is tuned for maximum power with these dual exhausts. Now, when Harley comes here for the Superbikers, they have to make some changes to their bikes. Chief among these, a large front disc brake to enable their riders to slow for the hairpin and the other sharp turns on the track, and a revamped exhaust system, a two-into-one system, which broadens the power band and makes the bike a little bit easier to ride. There's very little change, though, in the front tires. As you can see, in both cases, they still look roughly the same, a knobbly tire. With me is Jay Springsteen, who, of course, has ridden both bikes. Jay, what is the biggest difference between your normal bike and the way it's adapted here for the Superbikers?
Well, our normal bike is, the power range is so much greater on them, and then we, our Superbike here is, we have the two-into-one exhaust pipe on it, and it just sort of mellows the range out on the motor and makes it a little bit easier to control as though you go through the rough sections and over the jumps and stuff.
There is Jay Springsteen on the starting grid. He's in the second row. He'll be number 9 in the race. Should be a fairly wide open affair. Others among the favorites could be Scott Parker, Ted Booty, maybe Mickey Fay, Bubba Schobert, even Doug Chandler, who's no relation, by the way, to Danny Chandler, who won that first heat. About 5 seconds to go now to the start. And there they go. Going for the lead very quickly is number 67. That's Bubba Schobert. As they head very quickly into that first right-hand turn. Schobert, oh, now close quarters. And down into the hay bales goes number 11. That's Scott Parker. And with him goes Bubba Schobert.
Well, it's amazing, Jim, because first of all, Parker here in number 11 coming up on the inside trying to pass two bikes at once. But he first hits Mickey Fay there. Mickey Fay however, escapes going into the bales, and Parker takes out Bubba Schobert there. So really, there were three riders involved there. Now, notice how quickly Scott Parker pulls himself back together again. Remember, these races are very, very short.
And taking advantage of that accident very quickly is number nine, the favorite in the race, Jay Springsteen, one of the great motorcycle racers really of all time in this country.
Springsteen, his talent is just unbelievable. And you see his style here. Last year, he finished third in the Superbiker competition and gave Harley-Davidson, he's riding a Harley again this year, the first shot that they've had at looking good in the Superbikers. The Harley's a much bigger bike, Jim, than the other.
Number 12, Ted Booty is in second place. Not too far behind the leader, Jay Springsteen. Like the previous heat we saw, this is six laps to a decision. Still on the first and on the dirt track section of the course right now. In third place is Mickey Fay, number 59. Into the motocross section.
Mickey Fay had that incredible crash here last year, Jim. Right on the start, finish straight. Spinning around like a pinwheel.
Well, he's closing in on Ted Booty right now. Battle for second at the moment. Long way to go. But Jay Springsteen has gotten off to a tremendous start, thanks in part to that crash that seemed to have been started by Scott Parker sliding down onto that hard asphalt surface. Look out. Beautiful racing here.
And of course, the interesting situation that faces us here is Springsteen, with his early lead, is riding, as I said earlier, the big Harley-Davidson, which is said to be harder to ride. It requires more stamina, especially in the dirt section. So will his early lead begin to evaporate? Will he let it evaporate in order to save himself for the final? Those are the strategic issues, I think.
Mickey Fay has moved past Ted Booty into second place, and once again, the top three will move on to the finals. You don't have to win, you must finish in the top three. The surest way, of course, is to get out front and stay there, as Jay Springsteen is doing. But the race isn't over.
About to see the Ford Ranger leap to new heights in quality. Based on a survey of owner-reported problems during the first 3 months, Ranger quality was unbeaten by any major small truck maker. And Ranger has V6 power, more horsepower than Chevy S10 of the imports, and a wider cab than any small truck. For toughness, horsepower, and unbeaten quality, it's Ranger down-to-earth tough. The best-built American trucks are built. Ford tough.
Michelob. One smooth and mellow taste tells you all you need to know. Michelob. Some things speak for themselves.
Monday, meet a blind calf with his own seeing eye duck. And it's whoosh against shush in a downhill asphalt race. That's incredible. Then.
All right, for you.
They say you enticed them.
No.
You wanted to go to bed with them.
No.
When she says no.
Monday, all starting at 8, 7 Central and Mountain.
We're back in Carlsbad at the Superbikers competition. This is heat two for the dirt track racers. The leader, Jay Springsteen. There he is on motorbike number 9. What's he pointing at there?
I don't know. He's just come by the pits and he's pointing to something. It looks mechanical. I mean, the problem with the gear shift or something that he's hit the bike.
That would be too bad because he was an easy leader in this race. Still in first place, of course, ahead of Mickey Fay, number 59. But Mickey is not letting him get away. In fact, he's closing in on him now. It really appears that he has a problem, doesn't it?
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out what it could be. I mean, obviously, it's not with the motor. The bike is running okay. Sometimes, especially on this course where the riders brush by the hay bales, he might have hit the gear lever or something like that. He might be having trouble selecting the gears. If so, we'll see him slow out of the slower turns where maybe he can't get a low gear.
Like out of the hairpin right here?
Yeah.
Let's see. There they come around. Number 44, by the way, is Alex Jorgensen, who has moved past number 12, Ted Booty, into third place in the race. There they are right now. Up ahead is where the problem may be at the moment. So back again to Jay Springsteen and Mickey Fay, the closing Mickey Fay.
Well, all right, Jay was fine coming off the hairpin. So I think my first conjecture about the gearing is probably wrong. Here, this is the part of the track where you'd expect him to be at his very best, and he's losing ground to Mickey Fay.
Mickey Fay really closing in right now as they're into the motocross section. A tough section for Jay Springsteen anyway, right?
Well, exactly. Because of the weight of the bike, Jim, the Harley-Davidson is 75 pounds heavier than the lighter Suzukis and Hondas and so forth, and it's very hard to manage it in the ruts.
Look at that battle for third, fourth, and fifth, but it's still Jorgensen and Booty, but Doug Chandler is making a big bid to move into fourth place.
There.
Yeah.
Oh!
Oh! That looks like it's in. The hand in the air, and Jay Springsteen, the leader, drops back in the pack. It looks like he's headed for the pits. A brand new leader, Mickey Fay.
Well, we certainly don't know what happened there, but the bike is running all right, so maybe I'm back to thinking it was something to do with the gearing. Same place that he had trouble last lap.
Okay, so now Mickey Fay has quite a decent lead over second place, number 44, Alex Jorgensen. Then we have Ted Booty and Doug Chandler batting for third place in the race, and there is Jay Springsteen into the pits.
You know, it's remarkable. Both the Harley-Davidson team and the Honda team, they're the best prepared teams for this particular event, Jim, for the last couple of years. So Harley has now suffered a real setback, while, of course, Honda's looking very good by comparison.
And there is the disappointed Jay Springsteen. However, he should get a second chance. Remember, there is a sort of second chance or repechage heat coming up later for those who did not qualify in the first three heats. But right now, Mickey Fay is looking like a real solid qualifier for that final. Second place still, Jorgensen. And then the battle for third place, Ted Booty and Doug Chandler. There's Chandler, number 81, moving in now on Jorgensen. He's already passed Booty. He's trying to take second place in the race. And he does. But the leader is still Mickey Fay. The race goes on.
Before you buy the new Michelin XA4 all-season radio, remember this. Every XA4 has 20 million miles of testing behind it to prove it performs like a snow tire, and like a tire designed for the rain, and like a great handling highway tire, and to prove it keeps on performing mile after mile after mile. After 20 million miles, the Michelin XA4 proved it had nothing left to prove. Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires.
I'll never forget.
The memories are waiting in the new Winter Olympic stamps at the post office.
Tuesday, Ty Babylonia and Randy Gardner are caught in the crossfire on Heart to Heart.
Jack in the Box takes the burger to new heights.
The first Swiss and Bacon Burger Supreme. We combine melting cheese and crisp bacon on grilled rye bread for a whole new burger taste. This time, we even topped ourselves.
Hey! Aren't you going to compare it to the other guys?
The Swiss never takes sides.
New Swiss and Bacon Burger Supreme from Jack in the Box. There's no comparison.
2 years ago, Volvo introduced the Turbo. A four-cylinder car that could blow the doors off a V8. Now there's something new. A turbo that Car and Driver has shown can go from 0 to 55 in a scorching 6.8 seconds. They call it a missile. The intercooled turbo from Volvo. It does everything the turbo can do. Only faster.
LA's best homes, Monday at 3:30.
We return to this year's edition of the Superbikers. We're in Carlsbad, California, and this is Jim McKay reporting with Sam Posey. The leader in the race, well, it's Mickey Fay. There he is, age 24, from Seattle, Washington. Hasn't had much luck in the Superbikers before. Eighth in the dirt track heat in 1980, seventh the next year, fifth in 1982, but he's number one in this heat right now. A good lead, too, that he has at the moment over number 81, who also is quite a story. That's Doug Chandler. There in the pits, Jay Springsteen, who had led this heat until he was forced to retire with a mechanical problem, trying to get himself in shape for the repechage, the second chance heat, which is yet to come. They're the leader, though, Mickey Fay, number 81.
You'll see behind him as he takes a look at him. 81 is Doug Chandler, just 18 years old, the rookie of the year on his circuit of dirt track.
Well, this is the final lap, the final time that they make that transition from pavement onto dirt. Mickey Faye now with about 8/10 of a mile or a little bit less between him and the checkered flag.
And in third place, as you see on this wide shot, none of the first three has a problem at the moment. In third place is number 44, Alex Jorgensen. But you know, Chandler, the kid, is actually closing in on Mickey Faye right now. You think Faye is just kind of cooling it a little bit?
Well, it's very tough to cool it as a motorcycle rider, Jim, because the minute you try to lay out of the pace, up your whole system of reflexes, especially on the dirt. You really have to be aggressive to ride on the dirt. And the minute you try to ride it, do you understand what I mean? Halfway, you don't ride it well at all.
I understand what you mean, and I think it's not only true of that, but in almost any sport, and from football to golf, when you try to take it easy, you lose the rhythm of the sport. Anyway, Mickey Faye headed for the finish. Looks like he should hold it. Here comes Doug still after him. As they head for the chicane and the checkered flag, Mickey Faye will win it. Mickey Faye, the winner, Doug Chandler second, and Alex Jorgensen third in the dirt track heat. Yet to come, another heat for the road course racers, and after that, the repechage or wild card heat for those who have not qualified to that point. Three more qualifiers will come from that one. There's a very happy number 81, Doug Chandler, who finished second at the age of 18. We would like to find out, however, what happened to Jay Springsteen. Sam's with him now.
Jay, an obvious disappointment.
Yeah, sure was. We had a couple problems earlier in the week. We was out here testing, and we had transmission problems. And we've never had them before, ever. You know, we had the dirt tracks on the miles, half miles, TTs. Never had that problem before. And then here, it's physical, dynamic, you know, to you know, get around this place. And, you know, I blew three trannies already. Well, this is the third one today, so. And I was winning the race, but you got to get there at the checkered flag before you can finish the thing, so.
Okay, what can you do now? You have an opportunity to be in the last chance heat. Can you get it ready in time for that?
Well, we got another motor, so we're going to jerk the motor out of our other chassis. And hopefully the power range and everything will be similar to what we've been used to, so we'll just jerk the other motor out and throw it in there, and hopefully we'll have it ready for the main event.
All right.
We're going to make it to the main event.
I know you've got a rush. Thanks very much.
All right, thanks, Sam.
Six riders then have qualified for that final, the three from the dirt track heat being Mickey Faye, Doug Chandler, and Alex Jorgensen. Yet to come, the road course heat and that wild card or repechage heat. We'll be back for our coverage of those in a little while. Carlsbad, California, preparing now for what you might call a wild card or last chance heat. Last chance for those who have not qualified so far to make it into the finals of this Superbikers 5 competition. Now, we've already had individual heat for the motocross men, for the dirt track racers, and the road racing heat has also now taken place. These, of course, are the men who race on the high-speed asphalt road courses of the world at speeds up to 180 miles per hour. Their year-long circuit is very similar to the Formula One automobile race circuit. There they were, ready for the start, and there they went. Three to qualify for the final, as in each of the heats at the Superbikers competition. And it was Eddie Lawson in black and yellow, number 21, very quickly taking the lead as they went into the first turn. Lawson then, with a quick early lead over Dave Aldana, number 40, and Steve is a two-time winner of this championship in previous years on motorbike number two. As for Dave Aldana, he's always had hard luck in this competition. He's been in it for several years. Last year, he broke his leg. But at this point, he was looking very good in the road course heat. Easy leader, though, still number 21, Eddie Lawson. And behind him, Aldana and Wise. But watch closely now, because there's Aldana going wide towards the side of the course and gesturing in despair. He was out of it again. This time, the motorcycle had done him in. At the end, then, the winner, Eddie Lawson, had led from start to finish in the road course heat of the Superbikers. Second place going to Steve Wise. There he was on motorcycle number two. And third place, eventually, to Fred Merkel. Now they're on the line for the wild card heat, but Jay Springsteen, whose machine broke down in an earlier heat, still isn't quite ready.
They seem to be working pretty frantically on your bike.
Yeah, we're working furiously. As you can see here, we took the motor out of our other chassis here, and we're going to try to put her in the other one here. It's a little different combination of motor, so, like I say, hopefully the power range, I can make it work on the racetrack. So
where will that be the toughest, on the pavement or the dirt?
Probably up in the pavement part, or the dirt section of it, because the power range would be so much more greater. It's more like our mile or half mile motor, so it's not as mellow or as the other bikes.
Do you ride better when you're excited or calm?
I don't know. I guess I'm all wound up right now.
Good luck to you.
Okay, Sam. Thank you.
So, three more spots remain to be earned in the Superbikers final. We'll be back in a minute to see who earns them.
You're going to ask your next television to do more, to play harder, and be more intelligent than ever before. More than ever, you'll need the Smart Set by Zenith. Only the Smart Set has Zenith's exclusive computer brain that senses uneven color wear in the picture tube and automatically compensates. For rich, true color, no matter what you ask of it, get Advanced System 3, the Smart Set. Exclusively Zenith.
Express.
Hi, can you get a package to Yugoslavia?
Absolutely, positively not.
How about Taiwan or Peru?
Absolutely, positively not.
Well, Purolator Courier can. We're more flexible than a certain express company.
We now serve over 100 countries, so the courier that delivers the most packages overnight in North America now gets them to even more of the places you want. Call Purolator Courier. You want it, you got it. Worldwide.
When you've got a big job to get done, get the small truck that's up to it. Ford Ranger V6. In a survey of owner-reported problems during the first 3 months, Ranger quality was unbeaten by any major small truck, import or domestic. There's a wider cab than any import, and its V6 engine rises to the top in power. More horsepower than Chevy S10 or any import.
My hero.
Can I call you sometime tonight?
Okay, but don't leave me hanging.
The best-built American trucks are built. Ford Tough.
5 seconds left.
In 1984, our Olympic hockey team will take to the ice once again an underdog, once again determined to win. This team includes Pat LaFontaine, the Islanders' top draft pick, Mark Fusco, the 1983 top college player, and Mark Barron, the show-stopping goaltender for Wisconsin. They're going for gold again, and just wait. Starts February 6th on ABC.
Jay Springsteen did make it back. He's on the last row in a field of 18 motorcycles for this wild card or second chance heat. Three from this heat to move on to the final. It's the last chance, and there they go. Going for the lead as they head for turn one, number four. That's the yellow number there in the front of that bike. That is Eric Gabors. Gabors going for the lead, and the rest of them all strung out behind. This should be wild and woolly and a lot of fun to watch. There's Gabors going down the next right-hand turn. See it all with just about a few yards lead over number 17, Jimmy Felice. Now Felice moving on the inside. Jimmy Felice takes the lead as they head for that long uphill straightaway, Sam.
And Gabor has fought an enormous slide there. Now, of course, this is in a sense a preview of what the final is going to be. The riders of all three different disciplines all mixed together for the first time here today. Very exciting.
Exactly right. And Jimmy Felice, there he is. He's only 5 feet two, weighs about 115 pounds, but he can handle that big bike. There he is, number 17.
And Eric Gabors is second right now. He's historic. He came here as a spectator 3 years ago, had a look at this event, and he's a European, and he said, that's something I want to do. This year he's doing it for the first time.
And doing it very well up to this point as they're onto the dirt track section, the rather flat and oval-shaped section that leads into the jump, which begins the motocross section. Gabors still second at the moment, but Jimmy Felice the leader over the jump.
That silhouette against, you can tell that we are looking west in this camera angle, and the sun is already starting down. And when they double back, which you'll see in a minute, the sun is in their eyes, which is a problem more on this dirt section where there's also dust thrown up than it is out on the paved section.
Okay, still police, and there's still is, there's number 67. That is Bubba Schobert moving into the fray. 17 police, though, the leader.
There's an intensity, isn't there, Jim, to this heat. I mean, this is the last chance. You've got to do it now or that's it.
You certainly do. There's the leader of a 28. Steve Eklund is moving up very quickly now. A real battle going on here. There is Eklund in second place, and Bubba Schobert is now third.
Eklund, the great mile racer. Absolutely at home at speeds of 90 miles an hour on dirt on the big half miles and mile oval.
Okay, so those are the top three, and once again, just three will move to the final. Those three at the moment, Jimmy Felice, Steve Eklund, and Bubba Schobert. Eric Gabor dropping back.
know, I mentioned the intensity, Jim. If they hit that speed of 100, 110 there, at least.
But, and look, as they hit it, that Bubba Schobert moving into second place ahead of Steve Eklund.
Yeah, he had the power there, and that's what gets it done for you, is power up that part of the track.
Okay, still a long way to go in the wild card heat. Last chance to make the final for the Superbikers.
America's meat and potatoes, McDonald's quarter pounder and fries. You're gonna be ready for it.
No one plays harder than America. All you meat and potato guys keep slam bam, building up an appetite for a quarter pounder, Coca-Cola and fries. A down-home taste from a down-home place.
McDonald's quarter pounder and fries. America's meat and potatoes. Dig in.
McDonald's and you.
Okay, everybody. What do you say we make it Michelob Light for the winners?
Catch you later.
Michelob Light for the winners.
Yeah, it's a whole new game when you're playing for Michelob Light, the rich, smooth taste you can compare to any beer you like.
Michelob Light for the winners. Michelob Light.
The Super Bowl's most valuable player, Raider Marcus Allen, stunned them on the field, and pitcher Tippy Martinez dazzled them in the World Series. But how will they do competing head-to-head in a variety of sports? The answer tomorrow on The Superstars, premiering for its 12th season. Then football superstars put on an awesome display among the palm trees of Hawaii. Joe Theismann, Eric Dickerson, Dan Fouts, Tony Dorsett, Todd Christensen. Just a few who'll be in the greatest all-star bonanza of all, the Pro Bowl, tomorrow on ABC.
Great racing under a Southern California sun. In first place still, Jimmy Felice. In second place, number 67, is Bubba Schobert. And in third place now, number 18, is the teenage Rick Johnson. Tremendous racing in the wild card heat. Three to qualify for the final, and these will be the last three to make it to the Superbikers final. Look at Rick Johnson now, number 18, trying to pass Schobert for second place, and doesn't quite do it. Gets cut off as they're in the motocross section here.
But Johnson has shown tremendous ability in this tight stuff here, Jim. He has a light bike underneath him, and he's able to horse it around those tight turns very capably.
That's number 18. Right now he's taking the lead. Just that quickly, 18, Richard Johnson is taking the lead from Jimmy Felice. Bubba Schubert third, now trying to move past Felice. And he also moves past him as they come through the chicane. What racing, Sam?
Well, exactly, and it suggests that the whole Superbiker format is so valid. A guy whose bike handles well on the dirt, excels there, then perhaps falls back on the pavement. Let's see how Rick Johnson does as they head up through the fast part of the track.
There's a look at him, the young teenager leading them all in the wild card heat. There, number four is Gabor's in fourth place right now. Still, the battle is for the lead. And Johnson now being passed by Bubba Schobert.
Passed again, Jim.
Yes, and by Jimmy Felice. And suddenly the leader's back in third. And now he challenges again and retakes second place from Felice.
Oh, incredible. He was able to outbreak Felice there, beautifully judging the braking for that hairpin. What a battle among these three leaders.
And you might say four because Gabor's has closed on one of them. See him, number four from Belgium. Ooh, this is just tremendous. And another bid now by Rick Johnson going on Bubba Schobert, and Johnson has retaken the lead again. Boy, he's young, but he's tough.
He just absolutely handles his bike in the tight stuff perfectly, with a kind of flair and abandon, and it's absolutely marvelous to watch.
And by the way, you can see that Gabor's number four has now moved ahead of Jimmy Felice into third place. So Felice, who had led, has now dropped back to fourth. There he is.
Again, thinking about the intensity of the sport, Jim, it derives not only from the way you have to handle your machine. I mean, look at it here. A split-second decision, you know, thousands of them, it seems like. But also from the fact that these riders, for the most part, are young. Late teens, early 20s. But your career only lasts until your late 20s. So the whole career must be packed into such a short time. Every race means so much to these motorcyclists.
And the fact that the career is so short indicates the physical near perfection that's necessary even to participate in this. They really have to be in good shape. Number 18, Johnson. There's 67, Bubba Schobert. There is Eric Gabor, number four. Those are the three who, at this moment, would move to the final. Jay Springsteen still in the race, and he's in fifth place, but really not going anywhere.
Well, we've seen that Bubba Schobert has been much more effective up the straightaway, which is the section ahead of them now, than Rick Johnson has been. Let's see what happens.
Yeah, Schobert's almost going like a road course. Look, here he comes again, just blowing past them. Fantastic, because he's a dirt track racer, but he really looks like a road course man doing that.
Anybody can twist the throttle wide open.
Look at this now. Johnson taking the lead again. Now, out of the hairpin.
That's fantastic. And now, of course, they're headed on to the dirt section where Johnson, who is a motocrosser, might be expected to excel.
Let's see. He has been very, very effective in the motocross section. This is the dirt track section here, the long, sweeping, oval-type part.
Boy, he tears into it, doesn't he?
I'll tell you, he really does. Does Rick Johnson. The race is to the swift, and at the moment, he's the swiftest of all.
I may not win every race, but I still have an advantage over these guys. I use the Gillette Atra. They don't. It has the advantage of a pivoting head. Atra is better than twin blade razors that don't pivot. See? They don't always stay on my beard, but my Atra pivots to keep both blades on my beard longer. So I get a better shave. Close, comfortable.
Get the Gillette Atra and get the Atra advantage.
Hey, everyone can use a little advantage.
Ford Escort. Just 3 years ago, we introduced it as the car engineered to take on the world. And has it ever? Our little engineering marvel far outsold every import car line in America its first year. Ditto the second year. And in its third year, Escort went on to become the best-selling car in the world, making Ford Escort a world leader at the very tender age of three. Have you driven the best-built American cars? Have you driven a Ford lately?
Saturday on T.J. Hooker.
He's just a kid. I shot him.
Then the Love Boat gets a new crew member, and it's double the fun, double the romance, and double the trouble. And on Fantasy Island, an ancient legend gives Rourke a fantasy he can't control.
Tonight, starting at 8, 7 Central and Mountain.
Young Rick Johnson, number 18, remains solid as the Rock of Gibraltar as we near the end of the final qualifying heat, the wild card heat, to determine the last three qualifiers for the final of this year's Superbikers. Rick Johnson, number 18, followed by Bubba Schobert, number 67, and Erica Boers, number 4. All three of those, as you can see, appearing quite secure in their places as we near the end of this race.
Secure, and they obviously are perhaps already thinking ahead to the final. But you know, Jim, as these men race here, think of the others who have qualified and did not have to run in this. They are back considering their strategy, their tactics for the final, while these men are still putting out a lot of physical effort, even if they are now almost sure of their position.
Very true. Rick Johnson, by the way, at the age of 19, hasn't done too much on the American national scene, but oddly, he's had some successes overseas. When he was 17 years old, he won a race in Venezuela. When he was 18, he won a Supercross race in Tokyo. But here he is now on the course, lengthening his lead in the Superbikers. And notice that Eric Cabors of Belgium is now closing in a bit on Bubba Schobert. He's got his place nailed down. You think he just kind of cooled a little bit, as we pointed out before. That's hard to do in motorcycle racing.
Yeah, but also, he's the kind of guy who has a gleam in his eye. He's not going to settle for a place if he could gain a spot. He just looks, and if there's a bike ahead of him, he goes for it. Look at that!
Whoa, that was Rick Johnson, the leader, talking about going for it. When you have your place locked up, he almost went off the course.
Wow, and again, Rick Johnson is riding such a loose race. It's amazing. Quite a job.
By loose, you mean relaxed, not...
By loose, I mean almost losing it, I guess, at every turn.
Let's be honest. So there are the second and third place motorcycles. Here comes Rick Johnson, number 18. A big day for him. He gives them a wheelie, crossing the finish line, taking the checkered flag. Schobert, of course, is second, and Eric Cabors of Belgium is third. So all of the qualifiers are now in. Jay Springsteen was sixth all the way in this heat, and he finishes sixth. He got a machine in shape to run the race, but that was all. So there, as you see, a wide shot of this two-mile road course. All the qualifying is done. Next week on ABC's Wide World of Sports, you'll be seeing the final. Earlier winners today, well, here was Denny Magoo Chandler, the defending champion here. He won the motocross heat. Then there was Mickey Fay, best of all among the dirt track racers on this day. Finishing first among the road course racers was number 21, remember, Eddie Lawson. And then Rick Johnson, winner of the wild card heat. So that was the story in the qualifying. This is Jim McKay with Sam Posey. Hope you'll be with us to watch the final next week. The executive producer of ABC Sports is Roone Arledge. Coordinating producer of ABC's Wide World of Sports, Dennis Lewin. The Superbikers was produced by Mike Pearl and directed by Doug Wilson. World Cup Skiing produced by Peter Engelhardt. Our director there was Bob Lanning. The coordinator is Carol Letty. The associate directors, Jimmy Roberts and Jeff Cohan. Technical director in Carlsbad, Jim Breeling. Be sure to be with us for this season's first Sunday edition of ABC's Wide World of Sports tomorrow afternoon with live coverage of the AFC-NFC Pro Bowl at 4 o'clock Eastern Time. Travel arrangements made through at a promotional fee paid by United Airlines. You're not just flying, you're flying the friendly skies. Last week, we saw the qualifying heats for this year's edition of the Superbikers, that contest to determine who is the best all-around motorcycle racer of all. The defending champion, Danny Chandler, was the winner of the first heat for motocross riders. The second heat, well, that went to Mickey Fay. That was the heat for dirt track racers. Heat three for the road course men was taken by Eddie Lawson. And the final wild card heat was won by Rick Johnson. Today, we'll see the final on ABC's Wide World of Sports. Carlsbad, California, on a beautiful afternoon, not far from the Pacific Ocean. It's the setting for the final championship race of the competition known as Superbikers 5. Hello, I'm Jim McKay, reporting from Carlsbad, where just one race remains in this year's Superbikers competition. It is, of course, the big one, the championship race. If you were with us on ABC's Wide World of Sports last week, you saw the qualifying heats to determine the 12 men to move into today's final. If you weren't with us, let me explain briefly what this is. Some of the best motorcycle riders in the world are brought together from all branches of the sport. A special course is prepared for them, which combines elements of road racing, of dirt track, and of motocross. Having been brought here, and we had some of the best in the world when the competition began, and we still do, we had at the beginning no less than four present or former world champions, no less than five present or former national champions. They're all brought together to race on this special course, and when it's all done, we have the best all-around man. Now, the big question remaining here now is, can anybody beat the men of motocross? There have been four Superbikers competitions previously. A motocross man has won every single one. We're close to the start now. A bit earlier, my ABC colleague Sam Posey talked with two champions, Steve Wise, a two-time winner, and Danny Chandler, who's the defender here.
I'm with two teammates on the Honda team, Danny Chandler and Steve Wise, both of whom will be in the final. First, Danny, how did it look to you when you watched Eddie Lawson's run? Pretty impressive.
Well, he's going really fast. You know, he's going to be really hard to beat out here. I figured he'd have a little more trouble in the dirt than he did, you know. But he didn't make any, doesn't look like he's having any trouble in the dirt, so he's going to be hard to beat.
Well, Steve, you were right on the road behind him. How did you judge Lawson's performance?
Well, I got off to a bad start. I was in fourth in the very beginning. And I never really was able to get up there and race with him and see his lines, so it's hard to tell right now from now. So I have to wait till the main and just try to get with him and see where he's making the time on me.
Do you see there being any opportunity for team strategy? You are obviously riding a different kind of bike.
No, I think it's just, you know, man for man, basically. Steve wants to win. I want to win. So I don't think there's going to be any strategy.
You're both looking awfully relaxed now, but something tells me that isn't what's going on inside.
No, not really. I'm sitting here trying to figure out where I can make some more time, if there's any adjustment I can do to the bike to be able to pick up the speed or just anything, because now's the time to think, and then when that flag goes down, it's time to go.
Steve, one last question. Physically, of course, you were a question mark coming into the event. How do you feel now?
I feel good, Sam. I think that my physical condition will be all right. The Superbikers track is getting rough, and it's going to be tough, but I think I'll be just fine.
Good luck to you both.
Thank you.
Well, that was a bit earlier. Now they're on the starting line. There are 12 motorcycles and riders out there. Looking down on them, one of our high cameras from a huge crane. We also have helicopter coverage and a number of angles that you'll see as we go along. So they've all qualified, 12 of them from four different heats, and now they're just about ready to go. Number one there is Danny Chandler, the defending champion, headed for turn one. It is Danny Chandler who takes the lead. Eddie Lawson with him in number 21 in the yellow and black uniform. Around that first turn, and Lawson going wide, takes the lead away from Chandler. Headed now to this somewhat gentle right-hander, it is Eddie Lawson and Danny Chandler. Lawson, the road course racer.
Exactly, and the man who had the fastest time in any of the four heat races that preceded the final, Jim. In every way, he's the favorite. To my surprise, Chandler is riding very tentatively at this point.
Well, in fact, has been passed by number 59, Mickey May, as they came up that long uphill straightaway. But now, just that quickly, Chandler had repassed Mickey May. It's remarkable. Here they are on the hairpin for the first time. There's the leader.
Lawson has established this big lead, Jim, but now, of course, he's a road racing expert, and you might have expected that on the pavement. Ahead of him now is this dirt section. There he is. That's what Eddie Lawson looks like. And you see him headed onto the dirt section, which he may or may not be as effective on as he is on the pavement.
By dirt section, we mean the kind of the dirt track racers so-called use, which is sort of flattish and oval track. But now they'll hit the jump and into the motocross section right there for the first time.
Yeah, from here on, it gets very bumpy, and there are ruts and all sorts of unevennesses in the pavement, and you have to have a real eye, especially at this time in the afternoon when the light is slanting across the surface, to see exactly how you're going to handle the bike.
Okay, Danny Chandler is still second to this man, Eddie Lawson. There's Chandler coming to third. And in third place, now number five, Andre Malherbe, the former world champion, has moved ahead of Mickey May. And this time, however, they're not going for 1, 2, 3. They're going for number one.
And I might say about Andre Malherbe very quickly, Jim, he has been, of course, world champion in motocross, but he's never won this event, and he's prepared to go harder than he ever has here before.
And Brock Glover has now moved into fourth place ahead of Mickey May, who's dropped back to fifth. He may have a problem of some sort, but out in front and with a big lead right now, road course racer par excellence, Eddie Lawson.
Now, Wells Fargo delivers money for more people than ever before in Wells Fargo history. With the helping hand, the greatest choice of times and terms and plans we've ever offered. Loans with fixed rates. Loans with variable rates. Short-term or long-term loans. Lines of credit. The great Wells Fargo loan delivery. There's just no end to it.
We're back at Carlsbad, the final of the Superbikers. And Eddie Lawson is still the leader. Number one, Danny Chandler following him, however, and Andre Malherbe, number five, is third. But very much in charge is this man. Now, a road course racer has never won the Superbikers. In fact, every one, as we mentioned earlier, has been won by a motocross man. But here's a road course guy out in front. The second place man, well, don't count him out. Remember, he is the defending champion. Let's meet him a little bit, Danny Chandler. Danny's a country boy, raised in Forest Hill, California, not far from Lake Tahoe. He likes nothing more than to shoot a little pool, then to get into his four-wheel drive and go up the country with his pals. Not the laid-back Southern Californian. Danny is a quail-hunting mountain man.
I think everybody needs, you know, time at home. Being on the road too long just fumbles up your mind, and you really can't concentrate on racing. So I really need the mountains, yeah. I need to go out and do my thing when I want to do it. Everything outdoors that I like to do is here. You know, I think I'm an outdoors person more than indoors, so I need the mountains.
Danny first rode a motorcycle sitting on his father's lap, but soloed at age 5 and raced at age 7. He likes to drive just about anything with a motor in it. One of his current favorites is a sport called four-wheeling.
Good boy. You know, I like crawling up on little rocks and going through real tight places, and I like things that are real, you know, intense, that you have to really think about, and that also gives you a really good rush, you know, like dropping off and coming up on two wheels or three wheels, the truck feels like it's going to roll, you know, that scare. I live for that, I think, too. I like that, where it grabs you down by the heart and says, ah, I like that.
In 1982, Danny Chandler had a hot streak at Carlsbad, winning the U.S. Grand Prix and the Superbikers in the same season. That year, he also led the U.S. team to victory in an important team competition in Europe. He lives in Forest Hill with his wife, Tracy. Danny Chandler, going up the country, but in style.
It feels good after a hard weekend.
But this particular hard weekend isn't over yet. Not for Danny. In fact, he has a tough job cut out for him. So trying to catch this man, Eddie Lawson, number 21, who has that big lead. That's Danny, however, on motorcycle number one, still in second place. But Eddie Lawson, well, he's a fellow from Ontario, California, a road racer. Ontario, of course, you and I remember, Sam, as a hotbed of automobile racing for a few years when they had the big super track up there. But he started riding motorcycles at a very young age. In fact, his grandfather taught him how to ride a bike.
Well, he's no stranger to the superbikers, Jim. He's raced here three times before, and in 80 and 81, he was third. So he's always been very capable here. It's almost as if the year off that he took last year enabled him to put the pieces together and know exactly what he would have to do here to win.
Well, he must know a little bit more than he did about the motocross sections of this course, because, as we know and said, no road course racer has ever won this competition, neither has a dirt track man. Only the motocross men have solved the mystery before. I wonder what it is specifically that he's learned.
Well, it might be not something he's learned, but something his bike manufacturer's learned. He's riding a Yamaha. They've never been a factor here before. It's always been Honda. Now maybe they know something that Honda only used to know.
Well, this particular race and this championship isn't over yet. We'll be back to see how it finishes. Well, this may be the story all day in the final of the Superbikers, or could it be the lull before the storm? Eddie Lawson, number 21, in the beautiful yellow and black uniform, just stretching it out, leading his opponents all the way in the final for the Superbikers Championship of this season. Second place, the defending champion, Danny Chandler, hasn't seen him able to eat into that lead at all.
Well, but is Lawson stretching it out, Jim? You see, after all, Chandler got that bad start. Now, I don't know whether his timing was bad, something was wrong with the bike, he fitted the wrong tire, something of that kind. But he has held, you know, the same gap now for over a lap. Chandler is the kind of guy that either wins or loses. So I wouldn't be surprised to see something happen from him.
Lawson is a name you should be hearing more and more in sports circles, because in his first year on the international road racing circuit in Europe, he was fourth overall for the season. And many people are saying, well, he could be the champion, maybe even next year.
Well, you know, think of what that means to him, to Eddie Lawson, Jim. I mean, 2 or 3 years ago, when he was first doing the Superbiker, he was just another guy, part of the competition. Very good, but just another guy. Because of his season in Europe this last year, he is now, of all the men we're watching race, the man with the biggest future, the prospects for earning the most money, for becoming the most famous. Eddie Lawson is the man of the moment, and look at what it's done to his confidence as he approaches this event.
There he is, headed down that hill to the hairpin yet once again. We've been watching, as you were talking there also, Sam, with a pretty good battle for third place. There's Danny Chandler in second place. Here come Andre Malherbe and Brock Glover battling for third, and Glover right there. Just passed Malherbe and took over third place, passing a former world champion. Not bad.
Not bad, and did you see that he kind of rubbed it in a little bit by giving him a little wave? That's what Stirling Moss always used to do, the great racing driver. He'd give the opponent he just passed a little wave, like it was so easy and so gentlemanly. Thank you for letting me by.
As if to say, see you around, or arrivederci.
Exactly. Okay, Chandler leaping into the air over that jump. Chandler, his acrobatics are just beautiful to see.
Well, there's a good look at Danny Magoo Chandler going for a second straight Superbikers Championship. He's got to figure out some way to catch that guy in front of him.
Yeah, but he is now a little bit closer than he was last lap.
You think he is?
Yes.
Of course, is it possible that Eddie Lawson is also taking it just a bit easy?
Well, now this raises the question of fitness. In the past, the road racers have not been as fit as the motocrossers. We could see that factor becoming involved here.
But that's the way the situation stands right now. Good long way to go.
We're back in Carlsbad, California. This is Jim McKay with Sam Posey reporting on the final heat for the championship of Superbikers 5.
In second place there, number one is the defending champion, but in the lead is number 21. That's Eddie Lawson. Number one, of course, being Danny Magoo Chandler. And there he is coming through this turn. He is, however, a good deal closer than he was earlier in the race. But it's been a very slow grinding eating into the lead, hasn't it, Sam?
Well, Danny, in the past, was the kind of guy, Jim, that when he was behind, he went too hard too soon and usually fell. Right now we're seeing an exhibit of a lot more maturity. He hasn't tried to close that gap all at once, but he's, now that he's in the critical part of the race, he's gaining enough to win this event.
Well, Eddie, before the race began, figured that Danny Chandler would be the man he would have to beat. We talked to him, and he anticipated that battle.
Up in the dirt section is where he's going to have the advantage on me. It is getting rougher. The track is drying out. It's getting more slippery, more ruts and more holes, and I'm not really used to that. And on the other hand, there's more rubber on the racetrack, on the pavement, and I think, therefore, maybe I might have the advantage there a little bit. But watching him in his heat, he was very impressive in the dirt, and worries me a bit.
Well, it probably still worries him a bit, even with that good lead, because he knows that bit by bit, ever so slowly, Danny Chandler is still closing in, and they're in that motocross section right now.
Chandler fancies himself, Jim, as a man who does his best work under the most pressure. So right now, we might be seeing him, he's under extreme pressure, obviously, we may be seeing him doing some of the best riding of the year.
But still, he's not really what you would call in contact. He's got to gain another 20, another 30 yards before you really... Oh, he hit the hay bale! He hit the hay bale, and there's something clinging to the wheel of his bike. He's slowing down, no question of that.
Oh, that's... I was about to disagree with you, Jim, and say he was catching, Lawson at a fast enough rate to win. But he's out of it now. Look at that. Something... Let's look again. He just misjudged it. That's all you can say. See, the bales are wrapped in a kind of plastic, and I think he has some of that now wrapped around his gear-shifting mechanism.
Just that brief loss of concentration perhaps had his eye on Eddie Lawson, and not on...
Every evening, the ground crew loads Flight 207 for its trip across the Atlantic. But tonight, they know it carries something more. Tonight, Flight 207 is carrying our nation's hope.
Captain, all the Olympic team stuff's on board.
A hope that one day all nations will come to see that the true measure of the Olympics is not in the winning, but discovering the best in all of us.
Just about half a lap to go, and someone other than a motocross rider will have won the Superbikers competition for the very first time. His name again, Eddie Lawson, age 24. From Ontario, California, second place, still is the defending champion, Danny Chandler, number one. However, Brock Glover is closing in on him in a yellow uniform there.
Brock Glover has had some close finishes at Carlsbad this year, Jim, because earlier in the USGP, he finished second to Colquist by just 3 seconds in almost an hour of competition. Now, of course, he's in a position perhaps to be second again, this time coming from behind.
But the man of the moment is Eddie Lawson as he heads down towards the pavement for the final time, is on it, heads for the chicane, takes a look back. If he gets safely through the chicane, hits the finish line, it's all over. The checkered flag is waiting for him. And there he is. Eddie Lawson has won the Superbikers 5, the championship for this year. Second place will, in fact, go to defending champion Danny Magoo Chandler. And third place, very narrowly, to Brock Glover. Well, Eddie Lawson had been second in this competition before, third in it, but now he's the winner, and he'll hold the title for the year to come. Right now, Sam has moved in with him. Let's go down and have a word with the winner.
Eddie Lawson, a wire-to-wire victory. Congratulations.
Thank you, Sam.
You must be delighted. You said, and you rarely say things like this publicly, that this really did mean a lot to you.
Oh, you bet. Tell you, all week, that's all I've been thinking about, you know, just all year, actually, you know, but... I've been training hard, and I can't believe the bike just worked perfect. I'd like to thank the Yamaha team. They did a terrific job.
How about that point in the race when Danny Chandler was catching you perceptibly? What was going through your mind
there? Yeah, I was getting lap times or lap board up there, and I could see he closed within 2 seconds, and I tell you, I was starting to wonder, and I knew that I was losing it over there in the dirt part. I made a few mistakes, and I got a little
wide. Was that because you were getting tired?
No, I didn't get tired. I thought I'd try a different line over there, and I really lost a lot of time. I went high in the sweeper, and it really killed me, but it worked out.
Those last couple of laps when you had a clear lead, did it ever occur to you you were breaking a four-year tradition in Superbikers? You've become the first non-motocrosser ever to win this thing.
Great. All the better. I'd like to thank the Yamaha crew. They did it. I'd like to thank all those guys, Kel Carruthers and Keith and all of them, Baker, and they did a fantastic job.
Congratulations to you. It was a beautiful ride.
Thank you.
And one more time, there's the champion. A wave to the crowd, and let's have a look at the final official standings. Eddie Lawson, the Superbikers champion, followed by Danny Chandler, and in third place, Brock Glover. That's the story for this year, then, and for this day on ABC's Wide World of Sports. Always good to have you with us, Sam, and we'll be seeing you next time motorsport is involved. This is Jim McKay saying so long from Carlsbad. The executive producer of ABC Sports is Rune Arledge. The coordinating producer of ABC's Wide World of Sports, Dennis Lewin, who produced today's coverage of the United States Figure Skating Championships. The Superbikers produced by Mike Pearl. Today's program was directed by Doug Wilson. The coordinator is Carol Letty. And our associate directors were Bob Hirsch, Catherine Cook, Jimmy Roberts, and Jack Gallivan. The technical directors, Bill Morris and Jim Breeling. Next Saturday, ABC's Wide World of Sports will feature the dramatic Ironman Triathlon World Championship from Hawaii at 5 Eastern and Pacific, 4 Central Time. Travel arrangements made through and a promotional fee paid by United Airlines. United flies to Hong Kong from more top business centers with 3-class Royal Pacific service.
Spanning the globe to bring you the constant variety of sport. The thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. The human drama of athletic competition. This has been ABC's Wide World of Sport.
Brought to you by Bud Light. The best has a taste all its own. Satisfying but never filling. So ask for Bud Light. Thank you.